In this section, we start to describe in more detail a concept called collision theory. This is one theory that helps to describe how reactions happen. And if you remember at the very beginning of the chapter, we actually described rates of reactions being relative to the number of collisions between molecules. And so collision theory seems like a good fit here as we describe how we can affect the rates of reactions. And so again, collision theory is a way to describe that the rate of reaction is directly proportional to the number of collisions between molecules that happen per time. As we've talked about, we've already seen that as concentrations increase, numbers of collisions increase, therefore the rate tends to increase. We will start to talk about the effect of temperature in more detail in our next section. And so as temperature and concentration increase, we get more collisions, and therefore the rates of our reactions tend to increase. The key components of collision theory talk about effective collisions. So realize when two molecules are colliding in a container, not all of those collisions will result in the conversion to products. There are two key factors that have to be met in order to have what's called an effective collision. One is that those molecules have to collide with sufficient kinetic energy, and this is actually where the temperature factor comes into play. Of course, the higher the temperature, more kinetic energy, the more likely that that collision will result in the conversion of a product. The other one that we don't often think about, but that is very important, is the molecules have to collide in the correct orientation in order to make products. As an example of that, if we look at this reaction, if I'm going to react carbon monoxide with oxygen molecules to make CO2, I first need to have carbon interact with the oxygen molecule so that I can form a new bond between those. So realize in this first example, the collision is occurring between two oxygen atoms. That's not where we want a new bond to form. And so as these two molecules collide, they will actually just bounce off of each other and result in no reaction. In order to have this reaction take place, my carbon monoxide molecule has to be oriented correctly, where carbon will actually interact with an oxygen atom to create the new bond that we're looking for. That will allow this bond between the two oxygen atoms to break so that we can form CO2. And of course, this reaction would have to happen again in order to get our right ratios here. As another example, let's take a look at this reaction. Here we have NO reacting with O3. Again, for this, in order to make our products, we want to make NO2. That means a nitrogen atom needs to interact with one of the oxygens of ozone in order to form our products. And so here we see our speed trails. We can tell that this molecule is going that way, this molecule is going that way. Notice that what's going to collide are the two oxygen atoms. That's not where we need a new bond to form. So they will collide, but then they'll just back off or go in opposite directions from each other. And so again, for this first one, we end up with no reaction. In the second one, this looks more promising. We have our nitrogen coming in with an oxygen. But notice the orientation of my ozone molecule. So notice nitrogen is going to collide with this central oxygen. Well, if this is going to form a bond, it would actually have to end up breaking both of these other bonds to form that one. And so that's just, it requires too much energy for that to be effective. So because of the orientation of the ozone molecule, this one, the second one, will also result in no reaction. In order to get an effective collision, now notice we have our nitrogen coming in and hitting one of our end oxygen molecules. When these come together, we can start to break this bond between two oxygens and form a bond between nitrogen and one of our ending oxygens. So this will result in an effective collision and give us the products that we're looking for. So again, two criteria are effective collisions are sufficient kinetic energy, and correct orientation of molecules. Now, the measure of this energy that has to go in to make our products is a quantity called activation energy. So notice what's happening here. Specifically in this last example that was an effective collision, notice we're showing this kind of in-between state here, where we start to make a new bond and we're starting to break bonds from the original molecules. This intermediate state is what we call a transition state. It is a very high energy state, and there's additional energy that has to go in order to make this transition state. That can be represented in a diagram that looks like this one. There are several names for this one. The most common name is a reaction profile diagram. And so in this graph, what we're showing is the extent of reaction. In other words, if I start with complete reactants on the left side and end with complete products on the right side, my y-axis is measuring, notice, potential energy, not kinetic energy, but potential. Realize that potential energy of molecules and atoms is never going to be equal to zero. Right? The only way to get down to zero is at absolute Kelvin or absolute zero, which can never be reached. So notice we will never be down at zero here. So at the very left of our graph, we're showing reactants. For this example, we're using A and B as our reactants. And notice our transition state is the very, very highest state, highest energy state in this graph. That transition state is often marked with a star. For those of you going on to take organic chemistry, sometimes they'll mark it with a double plus here or just a star. But it's always the high energy state. So it means that we have to put in additional energy to get over that transition state so that then we can make our products. I'm going to change pen colors here so that this will stand out a little bit more. So the activation energy quantity that we're defining here is first of all labeled as E sub A, so energy of activation. And it is always the difference between our transition state, our highest energy state, minus our reactants. Notice activation energy does not go all the way down to zero. It's how much additional energy from our reactants has to go in to get over our transition state. The other interesting thing to note is that we can actually calculate an enthalpy value for this reaction. Remember that enthalpy values, let's change colors again here, enthalpy values measure how much heat is exchanged for a given reaction. Also remember we have two terms. We can define a reaction as endothermic or exothermic. So quick review here. Endothermic reactions have positive enthalpy values. It means the system or the reaction had to gain heat in order to happen. So there's an increase in heat. It's a positive value. Exothermic is where we have a negative value of enthalpy. That is where this system or the reaction had to give off energy as it happened. Notice in this example, our enthalpy is always calculated as our products minus reactants. Notice our products have a low value, our reactants have a higher value, and so the difference between these two would be negative. And so this reaction is illustrating an exothermic reaction. On this next blank screen, I'm going to show what our graph would look like if we had an endothermic reaction. So again, reaction progress on our x-axis, potential energy on the y. So realize for an endothermic reaction, I start with some value for my reactants, I have to put in additional energy to get over my transition state. So the transition state is always the highest energy state. And so now notice the measurement between my products and reactants is a positive value. My products are higher than my reactants, so I get a positive. This is illustrating an endothermic reaction. And now realize that we can also show our activation energy on here. So remember, activation energy is always the difference from transition state to reactants. And we use the notation of E sub A for that. Again, that would be calculated as transition state minus reactants. So if we're given values on the y-axis, then we can calculate or estimate values for activation energy and enthalpy. Before we do that, a couple of quick notes about activation energy. First of all, this activation energy barrier is one of the reasons that we rarely get 100% yield for reactions. Realize that not all molecules will have enough kinetic energy to get over that activation energy barrier and get over the transition state, and so we often don't get 100% yield. It's also important to note that activation energy is a defined quantity for every reaction. So every reaction will have a different value for that. Again, our calculation for it is transition state minus reactants if we have values on our y-axis. You might see reference to activation energy for a reverse reaction. We don't ever calculate that for this class. However, in our next chapter, we will talk about the fact that reactions can happen in reverse. We will also talk about the fact that reactions that have a lower activation energy are faster. And so if we think about two graphs, let's see if I can make two graphs side by side. So let's say we have one with a very high activation energy and another one with a lower activation energy. So I'm trying to show the same values for reactants and products in both. Notice my activation energy here is fairly large. Notice in my second one, it's considerably smaller. So in this one with the lower activation energy, more molecules can get over that barrier and get over it faster. So reactions with a lower activation energy will actually happen faster. And of course, revisiting our temperature discussion, the higher the temperature, the more kinetic energy, the more molecules, or the larger the fraction of molecules that can get over that activation energy, that transition state barrier. This slide is simply a summary of our enthalpy values. So notice here we are showing an exothermic reaction. They're using delta E, but that's the same as our measurement of delta H here. The graph on the right is illustrating an endothermic reaction. Oh, sorry, wrong value there. That's not the one I meant to circle. They're showing a positive enthalpy value. Heat energy had to go in order to make the products. So our last two examples on activation energy and enthalpy are to interpret a graph. Notice here we are given values on our y-axis. So three questions. First one is to figure out if this graph is endo or exothermic. And then to be able to determine the value and sign of delta H, and then to determine the value of activation energy. I'll ask you to pause the video and try to answer these questions. After you've done determining those, replay the video and I will go through the answers for these. All right, I'm assuming that you have your answers now. So let's go through in order. Notice here, this graph is showing an endothermic reaction. Our products have a higher energy value than reactants. That means that we know our delta H value has to be positive. And so remember, of course, delta H is calculated as products minus reactants. For this, my products look to be a value of about 10. My reactants, it's a rough guess here, maybe a 6 or a 7. Notice we do have energy units of kilojoules. And this value, this setup, confirms that we do get a positive value for enthalpy, which confirms our endothermic prediction. So that's our enthalpy value. To determine the activation energy, remember our setup for this one is our transition state minus reactants. So same idea, we're going to estimate to the best of our ability. That looks like maybe a 32 for our transition state value. Our reactants, again, are still going to be a 6. And so the difference between those is going to be a 26. Key thing to note about activation energy. Let's change marker colors again. Activation energy is always a positive value. You will never have to determine if it's positive or negative. I know in chemistry you're used to the exceptions to the rules. There is no exception to this rule. And that's because of the definition of activation energy. It's always the additional energy we have to put in to get over the transition state. So it will always be positive. And I like to point that out because as we get into calculations in either the next video or one after that, it is possible to end up with a sign error if you don't carry through your signs correctly. All right, so I've mentioned this in a previous video, but to ensure that you truly understand a concept, you should be able to work it backwards. And so one type of question would be to ask you to draw an energy profile diagram if we're given an enthalpy value of a plus 15 and an activation energy of a plus 40 kilojoules. Again, I'll ask you to pause the video and try to sketch a graph that meets both of these criteria. When you unpause the video, I'll come back and show one answer option. All right, so for this one, the easiest place to start is actually to pick where your transition state will go. I'm randomly picking a 50, but I need to make sure it's high enough so that I don't end up down at zero. So realize activation energy is transition state minus reactants, which means my reactants would then start at a 10. So I know my highest point, I know my reactants, and now I need to identify where my products are going to be. So if an enthalpy is a positive 15, that means that I need to end 15 kilojoules higher than my reactants. So I have my beginning, my peak, and my ending points. And when we connect those, we can get a graph that looks like this. So realize this is only one option. There are multiple correct answers as long as they meet these criteria. And that concludes our discussion of activation energies.